Nice. All right, you ready to start?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, Bas de Groot.
Yes.
Bas the Great for the Americans listening. Not the big, but the great in this particular situation.
I think so. I'm not sure.
You're not allowed to say it, but I can say it. Hmm. Yeah, so we met, what, almost 5 years ago?
Yes, five.
And you were about to go to South Korea to become an international milk endorser slash celebrity.
At that moment, yeah, it was. It was a really, really strange, act in a way. Also, the way how they invited me, it was really, yeah, ridiculous almost.
Why? How did they invite you?
I get a Facebook Messenger message from a really nice looking.
Make sure you look at the
Australian or not not Australian, but South Korean woman. But at that moment, sometimes you have that you get a lot of messengers from really nice women who want to do everything with you. So that was I first thought that she was one of them as well. So I just ignore it. And after a week, she just contacted me again. I didn't hear anything from you. And I'm from that and that company. And I have a really big client who wants to do a milk commercial with you. And I just Googled the company, and I'm not sure what the name of the company was, but it was one of the biggest marketing companies in the world that I think was also doing Coca-Cola. So wow. I thought, okay, this is serious business. But what was really strange, we had some chats on phone or on LinkedIn or something. I don't know how we did it at that time. And she said, this is the client. We are the company, the marketing company, but there is also a company for the that hire the people like actors. So I have to do the negotiation with them. Mm. And I thought, okay, this is really serious. And how do you talk to them? And do I have to ask how much I have to earn? Because this is not something like a 1 hour and writing your invoice. So that was really interesting. And after 6 weeks of negotiation, I went off to South Korea. And we had a really terrific week, me and my commercial partner at that moment, Mariska. And we worked 1.5 day, and the rest we were free, and we were just went on to Korea with the company who showed us everything and paid for everything. So it was a really nice holiday. That
it was a nice commercial too.
It was really nice commercial, yeah.
And they put you up on billboards and stuff, right? In Seoul.
Yeah, it was really nice because it was also a bit strange. We had some friends who just moved to Seoul, and when the commercial went online to start the new product, because it was also a new product, he just sent me some pictures of me. But when I was screening on really big billboards in Seoul, and it's really strange. But it's also strange because I was not there, so it's something okay. There was billboards about 8 by 6 meters or something. So it was really big, just on the big squares of Seoul. At that moment you think, okay, maybe this can be really big as that they recognize you, but you're not there. So it's
you're like the big Hollywood celebrities that then go live in the south of
France. I don't like that, but it would be great to just to experience it just once. So that's
just walking on the street and get recognized.
Yeah, that would be great. So but I've been back in South Korea with the international trade mission for the government, for the Dutch government, and it was just a small year later, and I was recognized just one time. So in that way, I'm probably not that big celebrity.
Okay, so for the people who don't know, you were the world's first milk sommelier.
That's what they say. I'm still not really convinced. There's something like the world records book or something. How do you call
the
it?
Guinness Book of World Records.
But there's also another one, sort of, and I'm in that book that I'm the first. Mm. I'm not sure. I don't care in a
you
way.
You dispute your own record.
I don't care. I don't care. It's nice, and it's always nice for media or clients to say that I'm the first, so or the only one.
So what is because most people have heard of a wine sommelier.
Yeah.
But so what is a sommelier in general?
A sommelier in general is that a person that really knows a drink really well and taste, and also compare it or combine it with food. So it's the pairing of the food and the drinks. And as milk sommelier, that's probably not really the good word for me. I don't do that. So I'm not a sommelier in the correct sense of the word. And what's also important is that the sommelier always works in a restaurant.
Mm.
So I had a restaurant in the past, but I don't work there anymore. So the word milk sommelier was given to me by a friend of mine. She is an artist, Sietske Klooster, and she invited me a few years ago. She heard of me that I have to start the story of becoming a milk sommelier from the beginning. And the beginning, I think, was when I was 8 years old.
Okay.
So that's a long time ago, because I'm now 44. I was going to a farm every year in Wezepe, that's in the east of the Netherlands, by Boer Bertus, Farmer Bertus. That was the first time that I drink raw milk that I know. And when I drank it for the first time, I was really overwhelmed by the flavor already at that time. I thought, wow, this is delicious.
Doesn't every Dutch kid do that when they have their first milk? It's like the heavens open up and they see angels.
I think it's really Dutch to consume a lot of milk. But I'm not sure if every kid has that. But I was really surprised by the flavor and the richness of it. And I thought, wow, this is, if I go to the supermarket, I like the milk there as well, but it was not that rich as flavor than I drink the raw milk. But the really interesting thing for me was that when I go the second day to the farm and I drink the milk again, the raw milk, and the flavor was already different than the first day. So, and then I thought, wow, milk has different flavors and changes all the time. So that was when I was 8 years old. Many years later, I think something like when I was the beginning of 20s, I worked on a farm, not a dairy farm, and I drink a lot of milk. I really like milk, so I just bought a lot of milk, especially raw milk from goats at that time. And so at that time I just started to drink something like 4 liters. In America, I think it's 1 gallon, isn't it?
Yeah.
4 liters. So a gallon a day, that's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Because I really liked it. And I did it for many years. And I was also at the start of a think tank. Edible Rotterdam, that was a think tank about urban farming here in Rotterdam. And when we had meetings, sometimes I brought milk to the meetings and I'd say, oh, you have to taste it because this one is different than the other one from the last week or the last meeting. And one of the people in that group was Rien Bongers. He's a company owner of a company that do debates on social issues, and he get a really big assignment from our biggest corporation in Netherlands, Friesland Campina, to start an online platform to discuss and tell stories about the dairy industry. And when he get that assignment, he just asked me, Bas, you're really a milk lover, you have to write something on my platform. So I wrote an article. I had to really think about it. What can I write? Because I can write that I love milk, but I think that's not really a story. But I was also trained as a farmer, and I knew that milk changes all the time. So I just wrote a story that, in my opinion, is that milk can be terroir. And terroir is just a word that you probably know from the wine industry. So
I don't know it.
No. It's really French.
Not that fancy.
Terroir. And it's that if you have terroir, that there's some sort of locality that you can really experience in your product. And in wine is really the region and the soil and that sort of thing. So it's also referred terroir. It's like terroir. It's the soil.
So when you hear those people making the jokes, like, oh, you can really taste the earthiness from the region.
Yeah. Okay. And in wine, it is really like that. But right. I, sure, in my course. Opinion, also as a farmer, I grow crops. If you grow crops, and I grow crops on different farms in different type of soil, then you know that. Crops act differently if you have a different type of soil, and they also sometimes taste a bit different. So in my opinion, if you produce everything what you produce in real connection with the soil can be terroir. And in that way, I think milk can be terroir as well, because in my opinion, a good setup of farming or cattle or dairy farming is that the dairy, the cows, go outside on the meadow and graze their feed or food on the land from the soil. So I just wrote an article and say, okay, everything what you produce in connection to the soil, also milk, can be terroir. So I just said at that moment to farmers, I think your milk can be terroir, and you can send it to me to taste it, and I want to sell it for you. Because at that moment, I had a farm in Rotterdam and also a store, Uitjaarstad. We will talk probably later about that. That was the article that I wrote. Because of the platform, there were more people coming to Rien to write articles, and one of them was Sietske Klooster, the person I already referred to. She's an artist, and she had the same she was also intrigued by milk and the differences. So she wrote my article, and she wanted to do some sort of tasting session. And she invited me and others to that session. Mm. And she asked me, how do you taste? And I'd never thought about how do you taste things, because in a way, I'm just a normal farmer, and I like things or I don't like things.
Is that different in a literal translation in Dutch? How do you taste? Because in English, that could also come across as a bit of a different type of question that she could be asking.
Okay. You have to explain. it was about flavor.
What is your tasting routine process?
Okay.
No, I get it, but the same as like, how do you paint? How do you taste? Because you're an expert, right?
Some people think that I'm an expert. I'm still not really convinced about it.
We'll go back to that later.
but she asked me to, how do you do that? So at that moment, I had a farm, including a restaurant, and we had I had some other restaurant colleagues, and one of them, she was a trained wine sommelier. So I asked her, Muis, she called. It's the translation is mouse. Mouse, how do you taste, and how do you do that, the flavor and the testing so she learned me how they do it with wine. So I told Sietske, okay, probably we have to do it like this. And she made a new project called the Milky Ways. And she said, I want to that you you join. And you are my milk sommelier. So then I was. So it's not something that I think or just thought of. So it's...
You didn't use it as like your Twitter handle back in the day? And
because we had that project, we just decided to use the word to get more information how you can influence or create the flavor in the milk. So at that moment, we just start to using the word milk sommelier. She put it on my head. Mm. So we used the word milk sommelier, and it was 2015. And at that moment in April, the 1st of April, the milk quota went off the milk.
What do you mean?
In Europe, we had rules that you can produce amount of milk or kilograms of milk.
So like a cap, like a limit to how
a
much
limit,
milk.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And they decided to stop that because there was more question on the international market about good milk. So Europe decided to stop with that, and it was on the 1st of April of 2015. So the media also want to tell that story, but it's a bit of a difficult story, and it's not really sexy in a way. Mm-hmm. So they want to tell that story by also creating some sort of other story behind it that is more sexy and more easygoing. So at the 1st of April, I get a lot of telephone calls from media, like the radio companies. So they can ask me to explain what was going on with the milk quota, but also tell something about milk in a more simple way. And they called me because I was the milk sommelier. Mm. And then you see that how media works, because when one person is calling you, then the next media is calling you, and the next media, and the next media. Mm-hmm. So that was the real start of becoming the first milk sommelier of the world in a way. So it started with the radio company, and then Sietske's really nice project called the Milk Salon, the milking parlor in a pop-up store in Amsterdam. And there was something like Munchies or something. It's an international blog about food. And it was an English article. And then you get the Daily Telegraph writing an article about me. And then you get a telephone call from the BBC radio if you want to go to London to make a radio show on that. And then someone listen it from an international marketing company. And then you get a telephone call from South Korea. So that's how it goes.
Yeah, it just kind of took off like a rocket.
And then you becoming something that was not really the idea. And it's still not the idea. I like being a milk sommelier, but it's not always comfortable because people really give me some authority because of the word sommelier, and I don't feel that authority.
Well, but okay, so let's, because I wanted, so the word connoisseur.
You can be connoisseur as well.
Because most people are going to use words like aficionado or connoisseur, things like that. And so, you know, if I tell someone that you're a milk sommelier, then it's not going to be long into the conversation before they might repeat it as he's a milk connoisseur or he's a milk aficionado or something like that. So it sounds like, I mean, you could have used any of those terms, but your friend, of course, used the term sommelier and it just kind of stuck, because I think there is this interesting juxtaposition of wine and milk, you know, because wine is thought of as so elegant and kind of classy and maybe even like snobby in a way. And then milk is, everybody drinks milk. It's, you know, it's like a very low person, like farmers and whatever. So it's an interesting way to name, you know, what you do as milk sommelier, because, you know, you are putting those two things together, the high class of the word sommelier and then the, you know, everyman per, you know, quality of milk. So was there, I mean, there was obviously, you didn't choose to go sommelier instead of connoisseur or aficionado, but would there have been any other kind of word that you think was a better fit?
No, this, the fit is great. In a marketing way, it's great, because this is, I think the milk sommelier was becoming big because of the word. Because I did do the same milk tastings, and Sietske didn't give me the name sommelier, then it was nothing.
So what was it you were when you met? So you were basically just, people were asking your opinion on milk in the beginning. So Friesland Campina was the one that you said was starting the digital outlet, and then they just kind of wanted you to weigh in and give your topics about the quota and things like that. And then
it was not Friesland Campina, it was the radio company. The media just asked me, not really my opinion, but to explain what was going on with the milk quota, and also including the story of the milk sommelier, because it's a really nice story.
So before you were ever like known as the, you know, milk sommelier, what is it that you were trying to do with milk, or what was your involvement, you know, with milk in
Nothing.
General?
I just only wrote the article because Rien asked me.
Okay, so you had the friend, he just asked you, hey,
he
would
asked
you...
me, and I think, oh, that's nice, because I did already wrote a lot of articles, especially on urban farming or in the past on anarchism. But so it's I like to write, especially the short blog type of style.
Yeah.
So it was really a nice question. Can you write something about your passion, fascination, yeah, your yeah. passion in milk? And I already did. I did tell something that I really love milk, and I drink 4 liters a day. Yeah. But I also want to create a more interesting story for the reader. And then I just put up the idea that milk can be terroir, and I still think that it can be. So it's not something that I just made up to only. Let people just write an interesting article. I want also to do something that they go to do something. Well, and the idea of that, and that's still the idea, is that I want to tell that story to farmers, because a lot of customers think still it's milk is the white stuff and it's just milk.
Yeah.
But the problem is that most of the farmers also think it's just milk and the white stuff. And maybe it's good to tell an anecdote about that.
Well, hold on. I want to go all into the milk. But first, what I think is fascinating about you is, you know, you hear a lot of people because you kind of got famous, right? A little bit. So
yes,
you hear a lot of people talk about like if you just kind of stick with your passion, stick with you stick with what you love, good things will come and eventually things can work out. And that's kind of what happened with you, right? It's like what you just said. You've always been passionate about milk since you were a kid, even drank a ton of milk in college, whatever. Because you were a farmer, you understand all of the science behind it and those kind of things. And then you have a friend ask you to write an article. You write the article, and then all of a sudden, it kind of one thing leads to another. And then, like you say, you're getting offers from the BBC. Eventually, you go do the South Korean thing, then CNN. You know, it's like you go all the way to California. So what was it like that moment when you first start getting, because like you said, that's what happens with the media, is it's like a snowball. Yeah. You get one person and then another reporter sees that, and they tell another reporter, yeah, kind of thing. So what was that like just as a person going from, hey, I'm just a normal guy, like I'm a farmer. I wrote this one article about milk, but then all of a sudden, you know, now you start getting these invites from the BBC and stuff like that. How was that whole kind of, you know, process for you?
It was really, I was a bit intrigued by it. Because it's never my idea to get in the spotlights. But this is not the first time I was in the spotlight. So I was already in the spotlights. In the past, I did a lot of things about social farming, like healthcare farming. And when I was doing that, I get also attention from the media. But it was never the idea. The same with urban farming. Edible Rotterdam was just one of the first in Europe who really was going into urban farming, especially inter-urban farming, is really inside of the cities, and we get a lot of attention. When I starting the farm uit je eigen stad, from your own town, we were the biggest at that moment in Europe in an inter-urban setting, and we get a lot of attention, also international. We went on every platform in the Netherlands, but also on Chinese television, on English television, everything. So we were on the spotlight as well. But that was more the story in general, and I was just one of the people who tell that story. But with the milk sommelier, it was a bit different because it was really going about me. Mm. It was not the story of social farming or urban farming. No, it was the story of the milk sommelier, and the milk sommelier was Bas. So in a way, that was really, I was intrigued by it, but also with a sort of distance in a way that... I don't want to be in the spotlight. That's not something that I'm really, I don't mind. And now we are sitting just in front of just one person. But if you put me for a room with 1,000 persons, I don't care either. So, but it's not something that I like 1,000 people more than just one person. I just like the story in a way, or the feeling that I have. But that in the milk sommelier, especially all those attention, was really strange, because if you go to South Korea, I earned ridiculous a lot of money just for 1.5 day. It was great because it gave me some more space and freedom for the rest of the year. But it was also strange how people react on you on the film spot. It was, and I was we were flying to Seoul, from that to Jeju Island, and we were in a really nice hotel. It was great. That was already a bit of star thing, but I didn't recognize it at that moment. And then we go to the spot where we just film the commercial, and there were 50 people, 50, 50, who just walking around me, and I had something like 5 people only taking care of me. There were people who just makeup and food and are you warm enough and do you want anything. So there was really like a star thing, and it's at the end of the day I was really fed up with it.
Yeah.
Because I want I think they're I was also a really difficult client for them, because but this was strange, and it was also with the rest. So, and especially what I find intriguing, but also a bit uncomfortable still, is that people talk to me that I'm the authority about the topic. And as I already referred, in the land of the blind, I think one eye is king. But I still, the interesting thing is that every time I learn more about a topic, I know that I have to learn much more. So because you learn something, and you know that there is still a lot more to learn. So in the beginning, you think as you start, especially with younger people, you see that they think they know everything about a topic. But if you know more, you know that there is much more to know. So
we talked about that a bit on the podcast in previous episodes, the Dunning-Kruger effect, I think that's what it's called.
Okay.
Where you basically, like, you start off here, which is at zero, and then you start to get a little bit of knowledge about something, and you think, oh, wow, I think I actually know quite a bit about this. And then all of a sudden you learn a little bit more, and you're like, oh, my gosh, I know nothing, you know?
Yeah.
Now you realize how much is out there. And then at that point, you actually start to underestimate your knowledge because of how much is out there. But you actually, at that point, have to have a pretty good bit to be in that conversation.
Yeah, no, it is, but it's always a bit uncomfortable. So
is that also a little bit of insecurity in a way of like when people kind of like that, what they say of the imposter syndrome stuff of when people start to make you any kind of an expert?
It's not that I'm not insecure about it, but I think it's always a bit, I don't like it when people look up to me. So that's more the I just
why?
Referred.
Is there anything?
No, it's also I referred that I also wrote articles about anarchism, and anarchism for me it's just one of the sources that I drink of, and for me I don't like anyone to be above me, but I don't like to be that people are under me. I lived also a short time in my life in Ghana, and if you are a white male, there's a lot of people who really act to you as the that you are the boss or you're more, and I hate it. So I don't like people who are, I don't know the words in English, but if they get sort of on they kruipend, they go to crawl for you because you are the person, and I don't like that.
Why did you go to Ghana?
It was because my girlfriend, she had her master thesis over there. And had many time at that moment, so I just went off following her for a few months.
So how long? So you lived there for what?
Just only 4 months.
4 months.
Yeah, it was not that much.
How was it?
I just brought her the first time, so she went to Ghana. I just brought her for 2 weeks, I thought that I didn't like to go out of Europe. Because I thought, what do I have to do in Africa? It's or in Ghana. It's not something that I'm really was curious about it. But when I went off the plane over there, everything was good. I really liked it and I loved it. So at that moment, I had a lot of I worked a lot, so I had a lot of extra time on my work. So I take that time, all that time. And I also take the time of the next year and put it all together in 3.5 months. And so I went off to visit her again and help her with her thesis. So she went off to small villages to do her interviews. And I was carrying all the paper at that moment. Huh? Now it's now in your phone, but at that moment you just have to carry papers. So So I've been there, but it was some sort of long holiday when she worked and I just went off in the Trotros. There are small buses. Just traveling a bit around at that moment, Accra or the places where she did her thesis, and I think it was Akrapong or something, but it was nice. But it's
What did you do every day when you were there when you weren't doing the thesis stuff?
Just go to the market or there. She the first months she lived on the university college. And it is really nice. It's a really nice complex. Ghana was originally from the English, so they created a university with the idea to build it in India, because that was also from them at that moment, but that didn't go on. So they built the same building in Ghana, and it was like an Indian style. So it was really strange in a way.
Wow.
But it was really like really, really big, long roads with the big buildings. They were wide with the sort of how do you call it, the slopey roofs.
Mm-hmm.
And we lived on the premises in one of the rooms of the professors, and it was really near the arboretum, so where all the big trees and the plants are. So I went off for a walk many times to the trees as well, and to go to Accra. Just went into Accra, as it's a really nice city to just walk around. And we had some friends over there as well. So the first time when we went there, we were hosted by a family, a Ghanaian family, and we lived there for 2 weeks with them, and it was great. So there were some sort of friends in a way. So they also took us around, and I just helped them with shoppings and that sort of thing, just normal life as far as possible.
Mm. Was there anything you felt kind of when you got back to the Netherlands after the 3.5 months that you felt like changed, or you were kind of different after that experience? I mean,
the only thing, but I think what Ghana brought me, and that's also nice to referring to the milk sommelier as well, that I really like to travel.
Mm.
And not only liking to travel, but also to be somewhere else where you don't know things. And what was really different in Ghana that I didn't experience anything anywhere else anymore is that Ghana was so different than our European style of life at that moment, that I felt in a way as a newborn, that you can experience everything new. So there, everything that you, what you taste, feel, or people, how they act to you, because in Africa, the way how they react on you is different than in Europe. So sometimes people look a bit angry, but they're not angry, or they laugh, but they're not really laughing, or they say something, but they mean something else. So that was is some sort of like new exploration in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I think Ghana gives me, that I really like to travel as a way, as an exploration. So just to see new people and see new behaviors or other behaviors than yourself. And I think it's it gives me something that I am more relaxed on other opinions of people.
Mm.
So it's always something like it's a bit maybe to going to the zoo to see to see another creature and really intrigued by his behavior in a way. And it's not that I see people from other countries as other creatures, but it's a different type of people, how to react. So it's in South Korea, it was also interesting. It's another culture than we have in here. But also going to the States, I've been to the West and I've been to the East, and it's to big cities and in the outbacks and go to the farms. And it's always interesting on how people react in that sort of environment and their culture and their social background. And
well, it's interesting because so I think you were my second English student ever, maybe here in the Netherlands.
Okay.
So I had some in Spain before, but and you were like super. I mean, I hadn't been in the Netherlands that long, right? I was living in Amsterdam at the time, coming by train. And you like kind of educated me on so many Dutch things. So you brought me my first drops. You brought me What was it? Stroopwafel. You brought me that really good stroopwafel from Gouda.
Gouda, yeah, of course. Where that, I come from.
Yeah, you.
Kamphuizen.
you brought me. What else? I mean, you used to just bring me tons of stuff, and then you would. We used to go through these walks, like through the city, like back towards Central Station, and then we would split up. And you would just tell me all about Rotterdam and kind of like the history of the architecture and this building and that building. And that was really helpful for me when I first got here, because like what you're talking about of when you go to a new place and you kind of realize like how different things can be from what you're used to. It was very energizing, you know, for me, but it was also like very intimidating because, I think the Netherlands is quite similar to the US, but at the same time, it's still very different.
Yeah.
And it was a great help for me to kind of have you like this super Dutch guy who's like super, you know,
I'm really Dutch.
you're quite passionate about, I think, Dutch, you know, like culture and stuff like that. And I mean, obviously, look, milk, you went with that whole thing and ran with it. But that was really helpful for me to kind of have, you know, somebody here to kind of guide me through all that stuff.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the walks at that moment as well. Yeah. But also that we had a really nice talks about what was going on in the States at that moment, right, with Trump at this moment, and you're coming from, I think, from what you called a blue background. Your father was a blue kind of job.
Blue collar job.
So that's also interesting. And Texas.
And at the time there were quite a lot of, you know, like Christina and I, last time we talked about the refugee crisis, and because that was, you know, kind of at its height when we first met, and we used to discuss that and all kinds of different things. And so one thing we never really did discuss much, you mentioned the anarchist stuff earlier, but so you said that you had attention from the media and stuff before you ever did the Milk Sommelier stuff.
Yeah.
And I only know a little bit about the farming, and I don't know what all you can discuss because I don't know much about the whole thing. But why? I know quite a few Dutch people where it's like, if you're in the U.S. and you say, I'm an anarchist, that just means like you hate the government. But here, if you say I'm an anarchist, there's much more like to that belief. You know what I mean? Like there's a lot more, I think, I guess, deliberate, like that stands for something here. So when you say like I was, you know, involved in the anarchy stuff or whatever, what does that actually mean?
It also involved in myself as well. So anarchy, I think I was 17, and there was one guy, he said, I'm an anarchist. And I thought, Dennis, it was his name, Dennis, I think you are a lot, but you're not an anarchist. But I didn't know what it was, so I wrote a thesis or something for Dutch lessons about anarchism, and I really learned a lot and all the where it comes from and that sort of thing. And at that moment, I'm from a left-wing background in a way, so I was really see it as a left-wing thing, as a what you have a sort of streams in anarchism, and the syndicalist stream is really dominant also in the Netherlands. So I wrote a lot of books. I still have something like, I think,
read a lot of books.
Wrote, no, what are you called?
Wrote them?
Reading, no.
You read.
Reading, read.
Yes. Okay.
There's the English teacher again.
Well, I mean, you can't just claim to write a bunch of books about it.
No. I just bought a lot. And so I think I still have something like three meters of books in about anarchism. Jeez. But also more the philosophical way. And it's, for me, it's more philosophical. So I want to be free, but I also want to respect the liberty of others. At that moment, it was really political for me. For me now, at this moment, it's more philosophical. I think anarchism is one of the sources that I drink of, but it's not something that really works for me at this moment. But what was... I started as sort of syndicalist. I also squat houses... in Gouda and in Maastricht. And
can you explain what that means?
A squat is that there's an empty house and you just break in, you go in, you remove the locks and you put your locks on it, and then it's yours in a way.
Why did that become, because it was like a squatters movement here in the Netherlands, right?
Yeah, it's more like the 80s, so I'm not that old. it was really a big movement. Yeah.
Why?
It was more in the 1980s because there was there were not much people who had possibility to hire a house or a place to live, and there were a lot of places that were empty, so they just squatted. And it was also the moment that we had a really big recession, so a lot of especially young people didn't have jobs, so not much money, enough time, a lot of empty houses, no place to stay, so you just take your ride and go into the house. It's more, I think, about the surrounding at that moment was really okay to just start going to the movement. And it was not only about living, but it was also about taking care of yourself, do it yourself. And that's the mentality that I still like. So I just want to do things myself in my own way and don't want to harm others. That's also why I'm becoming an entrepreneur. The idea is not to create things, but create some sort of liberty for myself to do things as I think I like to do it, and also take care of myself.
So what was it like when you, because you said you squatted houses in Houda, how was it like? You just go, you scout it out, you find one that you think would be decent, and then you just break in?
It's a bit more difficult than
allegedly.
Yeah. But you go to do especially a lot of research about, okay, who's the owner, how long the house was already empty, is it a house that has a living permit on it, that sort of thing. So there's a lot of rules around squatting. And at that moment, it was a bit more difficult than nowadays, because now you go on internet, you go to the Kadastar, and you find everything.
Yeah.
But it's nice to tell something about the squat that we did in Maastricht. We just find a really nice house. It was a really expensive one. And we break in, and we just find out in Maastricht on the Kadastar who the owner was and how long it was empty and that sort of thing. But that was the local cadaster, but it was not always up to date. So the regional cadaster in Roermond was up to date. Mm. So when we squatted, just a few days before, there was a new owner, and it was not changed at the cadaster in Maastricht already, but in Roermond. So when we squatted, it was illegal. So we get the cops in front, and they said, you have to go out. And if you don't go out, you're going to be arrested. And we just find out, okay, it doesn't really work to stay inside, because you know that at the end of the day, you are in prison and you don't live.
Yeah.
So the same day, we just squat a few other houses with the same police, and then it was okay. But but nowadays it's much easier in that way. But there, the rules changing all the time. So in the days that I started, or the days in the 1980s, you had to go to squat a house with a bed and a chair and that sort of things to go put in the house and to say, okay, now I'm living, because there's a chair and a bed and a table. Mm. And when I was squatting in the 90s, the rules were already changing. And then nowadays there are other rules again. So you have to really get into the legal stuff before you can squat.
Because now there's like organizations and stuff. Like I have some friends who live in houses that are like, they're technically squatting, but like one of them's lived there, I think, for like 10 years, you know, and it's like, it's a whole system now.
But is it squatting or anti-squatting? I think it's anti-squatting.
Oh, there's anti-squatting. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
So, there's some sort of nice, I don't know the story anymore, who's writing it, but there's a nice story. If you say that your father is a left-wing person, then you was one of the squatters. And if you are, your father is more the conservative, liberal thing, like in the Netherlands, is the VVD or something, the VVD, it's they called liberals, but there's a liberal stream and a more conservative stream just in one. So it's not like in the States. But if your father was voting on the VVD, then you were an anti-squatter. So that I think it's not anymore. But
these people that I know that have done it, it was just basically like it's kind of more farmhouses, like kind of out in the country, and it's basically like they don't want him to get, I think, bought by some other thing. But then also, if you leave it vacant, then like not nice house guests might come in. So
but it's also a way, if you just anti-squatter, they can put you out every moment because you would just pay some sort of rent. Mm-hmm. And squatting is more like a legal thing. So if the owner wants to get you out, they have to go to court. But there's a whole in squatting. There's a more political background to why you do it. In theory, because a lot of people just want to live, and it's more like the cultural thing about being in a group as squatters that a lot of people just let them start squatting. I think for me it was a more political thing. So I didn't want to.
What were you trying to accomplish politically by squatting?
It was more about that I thought at that moment that if you have a house and there's a lot of people looking for a house, then it's not really nice in a way to leave it empty.
Right. So you're trying to make this point that
yes, yeah,
this is not a good situation.
It's not a good situation. Yeah.
All right.
Now as a house owner, I'm a bit and more capitalist part of my
anarchy
of my life
goes away once
yeah,
you
sometimes. But I think it's still but for me but and that's I think for a lot of especially young people it was squatting is really nice because it's really about doing do it yourself. So I squat the house, there was no water, so I creating a line of water, and we want to have a nice window, so we created a window. So I learned a lot about it. I learned to do things and not with my knowledge, but just do it. So my father is really practical, but when I was doing something at home, he just pushed me away. Said, I can do it. Mm. And now there was nothing to push me away, so I can just do it.
Right.
Okay. Just buy a saw and just make a hole.
Yeah.
Okay. How to close it? Okay. I don't know. Just. But then you have friends who can help you, and
so that was you said that was
pipe fitting and that sort of thing.
Oh,
it's
gosh.
Great, yeah. So
that was in the 90s. You said the yes, your yeah. school. Okay, so, so basically you go from high school, and then at some point you start doing the squatting. When is that?
I was 20.
And you okay? And so then when do you start with the kind of urban farming stuff?
The farming stuff was already. When during the squatting time. So when I was from Gouda going to Maastricht, I was working in healthcare. Originally I'm coming from healthcare and I had a healthcare farm in Maastricht. Then I went to Rotterdam. We bought a new house. Behind the house there was an empty spot. I wanted to, at the moment I go part-time to a school called the Warmonderhof, that's a biodynamic school, in a course that was about healthcare farming. And at the end of every course, you write an ondernemersplan.
A business plan.
So I wrote a business plan about a healthcare garden in Rotterdam on that spot behind my new house. And I had...
A healthcare garden.
Healthcare garden, yeah. Healthy garden or something. And I had I have to explain to the neighbor what I wanted to do. So I create them sort of open dag.
Just like a, I don't know. Oh, like open day is all.
Yeah, some sort of event, a small event to just explain what I wanted to do.
Oh, like a little town hall kind of thing where people. Yeah.
And I just created them sort of poster, and I said, "What about?" Farming outside, farming in the city. So city farming, something was that on the poster. And Rien, the guy from the milk, for the milk story from Friesland Campina, one of his colleagues just find that poster and they get it at that moment, get a small assignment from the local, I think from the international, for the national government to make some sort of event, a more discussion event about city farming. So they invited me to do that event. Mm. And it was a really nice event in a way. It was a small event. So we had, I think, something like 20 people around the table. And they were from really different backgrounds. So we had the real estate companies, the big ones. And we had, professors from Wageningen and also some practical guys like me, and some I refer them as women in flowering dresses, a bit like a hippie like people.
Okay,
it was a really interesting situation, because you see that the people from the real estate in the gray suits and the woman in the hippie like, so they had no conversation. They didn't find each other. And I was something with some other people more in the middle, like idealistic in a way, but also practical and just do it. And what can we do? So at the end of that day, at Portaal, the organization decided not to go on for the assignment for the national government, because there was nothing fruitful in that. At that moment started to happen. But I think, yeah, there are some people in the room that are interesting. So we put them back on a small table together. And we started with six people just discussing, okay, what can urban farming do for Rotterdam? And that become Edible Rotterdam.
Edible Rotterdam.
Edible Rotterdam, Ate by Rotterdam.
So what was that?
It was a think tank, as we referred it, about urban farming.
Can you pull that over a little bit?
Yeah. So... and we just discuss urban farming and look around the world everywhere on the topic urban farming for 3 years or something.
Why was it important to have urban farming here in Rotterdam?
There are more things, but the thing where it started with was more the social impact.
Mm.
But from the beginning, and that's because there were six people on the table, so Nicole... that was the founder of what we now call the Rotterdamse Oogst, the market. But in the beginning, they had a festival and a small restaurant called Van der Boer. Jan Willem van der Schans, he was from Wageningen University, so he was a researcher. Paul de Graaf, he's an architect researcher. He's also still in urban farming, especially in food forests. Cesar Peren, he's an architect from SuperU Studios. At that moment, 2012, architects were really going into using material that is already there to rebuild things.
Hmm.
Do I forget something? No, I think there were... Joost de Krieger is also from... but so we were put together, and it was really nice to discuss this topic from all those different angles. Marja Verstegen, she was from... Het Portaal, but she was really into the social part. And it was really, Erin, of course. So it was really nice to discuss from all those different angles the topic of urban farming and what it can do for Rotterdam. So the social impact, but also the food impact, especially if we look to the States, urban farming was more about food reliability.
Mm.
But they call it about, they in the States, they talk about food deserts. In the Netherlands, it's a bit different. But it was really nice to go from all those different angles, from entrepreneurs, from architecture point of view, from city planning, from business, from culinary point of view, all those types. So we talked with each other for 3 years. But... only Nicole and me coming from a background from that we want to do something. So Nicole started to the restaurant Van der Boer, and I at that moment just want to start also not talking anymore. Only it's good to know that I just quit the healthcare farm. I just decided not to do it. Why we don't leave? We leave it for now. So I want to start urban farming in the Netherlands, and I want to create impact. So with all the things that we discuss, I want to create something that has impact. And that, at the end, it's something like a road or 4 to 5 years. But at the end, the Uitjaarstad was there, and Uitjaarstad was the urban farm near Marconiplein.
So how did that create impact?
The idea was I want to put a farm in a real urban environment. And the idea for me at that moment was, I just had two other founders, but the ID for that farm was I was the person who just started with the farm. But my idea at that moment, I just want to bring farming into the city to let customers or burgers, civilians, just learn about where their foods come from. Mm. That was the idea at that moment.
So interestingly, because you were the first person I think that ever told me about the topic of like happy chickens and happy cows and stuff like that. And I had never really thought about it, you know, much before that. But now I think that is one of the things that I care most about is this whole factory farming stuff and, you know, how terrible that whole industry is. And so I have a colleague or a former colleague now, but he's also kind of an anarchist.
Nice people.
But he had this idea that, you know, every single package of food should have the information on there of how it was prepared and how it got to that point. And so it's like, you know, same with chicken or with, you know, gelatin, candy, any of this stuff, like he says, it should say on there exactly how this is made, because then he thinks a lot of people, you know, wouldn't actually buy and eat the products that they do. And it's interesting because so with this urban farming stuff, is that kind of part of the hope is that you're going to teach people to kind of connect more to the source of there actually is a place where this food comes from besides the supermarket shelf?
Yeah. That's what I also want to show them, just to see, let them show how things were working, but also that there are a lot of discussions and things, inner side discussion as a farmer, what you can do. And it's really nice that you refer to chicken because it's there's also a nice anecdote about chicken at Uit Je Eigen Stad. So for me, Uit Je Eigen Stad was more, the production of food was really a big topic. I found it really important that there was real production. But the main thing is that we were a story company. Mm. So I want to tell stories. And I want to tell stories by production. We started the first batch of chicken. We started with Ross 308. And Ross 308, that's what we called in the Netherlands as plofkip. So they're the fast-growing chicken. So we get small chicks from a university. They bring us to us. And Ross can grow from not from a small chick to a chicken for butcher in 5 weeks.
Jeez.
So that's a fast one. But we had a slow system.
That's like a tomato. It's insanely fast.
It's really fast. So that's the possibility of the ROS. But it's also, the ROS is created to do that. So the question is, if you put ROS 308 in another type of system, a slow system, is it good for the chicken? Because the chicken is created for that system. So we just started with the ROS because we were a slower system. Our first batch of chicken became something like 7 or 8 weeks at that moment. And then we put all the ROS, go to the butcher and slaughter them. But there was one chicken. Verstopte zich. So she was hiding. So we just missed her. So at the end, there was one chicken left. And we called her Rosa,
Rosa,
because she was Ross. And we decided to let her stay. So the next batch, and that was the batch that we really want to start with, that was Hubert 758. And that's a more slower chicken that can grow in 7 weeks. And in an organic standard, something like 11 to 12 weeks. So that's a slow chicken. A normal chicken starts to be adult at 20 weeks, so it's good to know that as well. So it's 12 is not really mature. But we just put her in the with the rest of the Hubbards, and we decided to let her stay. Because for us, she was a really good story. So when I had a tour around the farm, I show people Rosa. And I tell her, okay, Rosa is created as a chicken, a ROS 308, to go to slaughterhouse in 5 weeks. And she, the only thing that she wants to do is eating. And when she's getting really heavy, because the legs of a meat chicken is they are not really the in the how do you call it, in the breeding, they're not really focusing on the legs. So the legs are a bit too small for the big body.
Because they want the breasts.
Yes, yes. So we said, yeah, probably at the end, she will be obese. And at the end, she will have problems with breathing and also with walking. So the question is, what I asked them is, what is animal welfare for Rosa? Is animal welfare for Rosa to let her walk as long as she can and die by nature? Or is Rosa better off to go to butcher? And that was one of the stories that we told. And it's good to let people know that if she will stay longer, then her death will be not that pretty either. So it was really nice so that was a good story to really let people go into the complexity of farming and all the aesthetics, or the not aesthetics, the ethical part of farming as well. Maybe it's good to know the end of Rosa as well, to tell her. She went to become 32 weeks, dying by a heart attack and also having really big troubles by breathing. But the interesting thing was that she laid 2 eggs, and she's not creating to lay eggs. So that was really really nice, I think. And one of the eggs was also bred by a rooster. So she was taken by a rooster. So one of the eggs was also it was okay. So we put them in the breeding machine, in the egg machine, and there was a chick coming out of it. So that's nice. But when she died, one of my farmers, René, he was going into the stable, and she was laying in front of him, and he didn't see her because it was a bit dark. So he felt over Rosa, and so he take her out, and we just put her on a weegschaal, on a, how do you call it, scale to weigh her, and she was 7 kilos.
Wow.
So she was really, really heavy, and not so her body was just giving up.
So when you say these chickens are, you know, she's not created for that or whatever, you mean the way that they're bred and so the different.
So it's always difficult. It's not a really big topic nowadays, but at the time there was a really big topic about plofkippen, and they say they have to get better life. They need more space, and they get to have a longer life. But the problem is, it's not about the chicken, it's about the system. So we're creating a system, and with that system, we create the chicken. The chicken is the chicken that we created, is part of that system that we designed in a way. So that's also always interesting, because people see farming as a natural thing, and farming is not natural. Farming is culture, and it depends on the farm, on how in every farm there is a part of nature. So we it's some for orchestra of nature. So we orchestra the nature in a way, and it depends on the system that you choose, how much nature you let involved in your system.
That's interesting, because I guess like one of the technical terms, agriculture, you know, I never really think about the word culture in that.
I think the English word of agriculture is much better than landbouw in the Dutch. For me, it's really agriculture. I see also agriculture in general as a cultural act instead of a productional or a financial act. Well, it's also that, but cultural is the main thing, I think.
It is, but you made an interesting point there when you said, like, a lot of people think farming is nature, but it's really not. It's actually quite far from nature. So for instance, back in, I think, April, I kind of got on this big kick of trying to find, first I was looking for grass-fed beef.
I can help you with that.
I don't want to go into too much of the kind of like the hippie stuff of what I was feeling at the time or whatever. But basically, I was trying to find a way to. So I didn't like the idea that, say, these cows are just raised to be slaughtered. So even when I started looking for kind of free range cattle and grass fed cattle and things like that, they have these cows out in New Zealand, you know, beautiful cows, like about as close to wild cattle as you can get now. And what they do is they kind of raise them, and then at some point between the age of 3 and 5, they're slaughtered. Now, if you try to find online, like, what the actual, lifespan of these cows would be, it said that they could live up to 8 years old. So even that, I'm still thinking, like, I don't really, because if I'm trying to go as far as I can ethically here and say, okay, I want to go as far as I can, and then I'll stop wherever it's a reasonable place that I have to stop. But I thought, okay, well, having a cow that's slaughtered at the age of 3 when it could have lived to 8, that's not what I'm looking for right here. So even the grass-fed, like even the kind of, you know, and so the more research I do on that, trying to find out what is the actual natural lifespan of a cow. Well, they say we really don't know, because to be honest,
it can be 20.
Yeah, the thing is that wild cattle aren't really a thing. You know, like the cattle that we have today have been bred over so many, you know, thousands of years basically to be the way that they are. They're not really wild animals at all anymore. They're just domestic, you know, animals. So they have been bred exactly like you just said with the chickens. They have been bred to mature at a certain point, to have, you know, be lean in certain areas, to have fat in certain areas, you know, like all of this stuff has been designed by humans for so long that it's just like you're talking about. It's not like you would. And so what they said with a lot of these cows is that if they're not on a farm being looked after by farmers, they have a lot of medical problems, and that a lot, where a lot of the money from, you know, cattle farmers comes from, is actually treating these animals whenever they have, you know, sicknesses and the little different medical conditions that they can have. So basically the point was that there really is, you know, you have no idea how long a cow might live if you don't slaughter it, because that's what they're bred to do.
Yep.
So it's very difficult to kind of, you know, like if you're trying to find an all natural way to consume beef, it's not exactly easy, you know.
But the way is, do we want to have it natural?
I don't know.
I don't think so. It's good to know. It's good to my opinion, there's the 5 freedoms of Bramble for animals, and one of them is that animals can react as normal or naturally as possible. So that's, as a farmer, I want that to do, to really go into the chicken of the chickenness of the chicken, or the pigness of the pig, as Joel Salatin said.
Pigness of the pig.
Pigness of the pig. So what's a pig? If you go to look to a pig, what's a pig? What does it? Well, how does it behave? What does it like? And that's something that you create in your system and also use it in your system. So I think it's not. I think it's okay to slaughter them at the end in a way. And so I'm. As a beginning squatter anarchist, you have to be vegan. And I always become vegan, but when I'm starting at the farm, it was at the same time. I see, okay, vegan is not for me, because I think animals are part of farming, also for the healthiness of the soil. So, but go back to your question or your inner discussion. I think as person, you have to find a way for yourself what you think it's okay, and it can also be a search in a way, so it will change. And but if you think something and say something, then you have to act like it. So if you think that you don't want to eat meat anymore because you think it's not okay, don't do it. So that's your freedom, and it's also, but also your, not only your freedom, but also your responsibility to act in the way, in your way, in your own way, but don't bother me with it in a way.
Well, that's interesting though, right? Because this is one of those things where it's like, I totally agree with the anarchist kind of way of the libertarian, of like, you know, John Stuart Mill type people of, you know, if you're not harming anybody else, then I don't. But when you, what you talked about before is like, with the system, right? Yeah. This whole, and I mean, I eat meat, right? I'm not trying to pretend that I'm a vegan or anything like that.
I know that you eat meat.
But
I'm not sure if you eat vegetables nowadays, because I just start to know you, we just go to eat something and you just leave the vegetables, you only eat the meat. So
yeah, I've changed. I eat mostly vegetables now, and then a little bit of, I wouldn't say a little bit of meat, like one chicken breast for sure. Like one fillet of salmon.
Okay.
Deer meat. I eat a lot of deer meat now.
Okay.
But it's so funny that, 5 years ago, I think you used to go on those walks, and then I would stop at Burger King at Central Station after.
Yes.
But to that point though, it's what I'm trying to say is that that whole system exists to feed people, right? And so it is kind of one of those things that if all those people who think that it's wrong just sit back and say, okay, well, and other people say, well, just don't come at me with it. You eat what you want to eat, I'll eat what I want to eat. But if everybody kind of continues to do that, the system itself doesn't change too much. And I think that, I guess where the, you know, maybe it goes too far when you're telling people that they should not eat meat at all. But I do support the people who are trying to kind of bring awareness and bring a stop to the level of factory farming that we've gotten to now, because it's just so out of control. And, and
like, but that's what I just wanted to show them at Uitjaarstad, and I still want to do that. So what I do is I tell my story, as in this case, I'm a farmer again, growing vegetables, but I want to take people on the land and tell what I do and what sort of decisions I make, in which context and with targets I have. So it's also about what's your vision, targets, what's your the context, and what's your the means that you have, like money, tractors and that sort of thing, and that decide what you're going to do. And the context is about soil and location and that sort of thing. So it's more that I tell that, and sometimes I also tell that I have higher goals. So for my new farm, I want to go to no-till, but I know that I cannot.
What does that mean, no-till?
I don't want to throw over the soil anymore. So I want to leave the soil intact as much as possible. Mm. But I know that in the first years, I need to till it in the beginning. So I just bought a new tractor. It's will coming in the 1st of March,
That's
I hope.
Exciting.
A Ferrari. Very nice one, a green one. Just to till the soil. And I think, and I hope that in this year I will till the soil, I think, 5 times. And then I think next year it will be 2 times. And after that, I hope it will manage to do it only once a year and only in a small first 5 centimeters of the soil. So that's my goal. But how to get there, this is what I hope. But maybe I need to do more, and this was the same. So I tell them all the things that I'm taking in consideration to do that. And then I ask them, do you think that's okay? Then you buy it with me. If you don't think it's okay, I don't care, then you buy something somewhere else. So that was the same at Uitjaarstad. That's I wanted to tell the story, and I want to show them what to do and how I did it. And I don't feel offended if someone chooses differently.
So what does that accomplish? Because so you're talking about you have a farm now, and you're selling that to people in Rotterdam or The Hague?
I sell directly to, so it's what they call it in English, it's called CSA, Community Supported Agriculture. Mm-hmm. In the Netherlands, we call it Pergola Associatie of Gemeenschapslandbouw. And what I do is that I'm a farmer. I farm on a piece of land. And I have customers, and the customers are part of my farm. So they are shareholders. Mm. In English, they call it shareholders. So they pay me upfront for the whole season, and they, in my case, they can harvest every week.
So they have to come there and harvest it?
They have to harvest, yeah.
Oh, man.
So they go there, and they can harvest. And my season is from the 1st of May till the end of November. So, and I say that I can grow something like 5 crops a week. In the beginning, it will be less, and in summertime, it's more. And in the winter, it will be also a bit less than 5. And they can harvest. But for me, it's also that's what I like. It's also for me that there's a community around it. So I like that. I like a lot of people around me. And I think it's also nice. They have to be on the land to harvest their stuff, and they can ask me a lot of things.
How many people do you have doing this now?
I just started, so it's my first season on the new location. So at this moment, I have 16 mouths to feed, 16, as a start. But I just started just 1 month, and there is no...
Wow, 16 people in a month?
There's not much, there's nothing to see yet. So it's because it's really wet at this moment. So I'm still okay, and I didn't do much about marketing. So my goal is to have at least 60 to feed this year, and hopefully 100.
That's why you came on the Lucas Weaver show.
Of course. You know, I'm always into marketing and that sort of thing. I always want to sell. No, I don't want to. because I'm convinced that people will come.
No, but so what you're kind of offering people is the chance to see where their food comes from.
Yeah.
So like a lot of people go buy their food from the market because they assume that it's local and they assume that it's fresh and all this stuff. But so for you, they actually have to come harvest it themselves. Yeah. So they get the chance to basically share a farm in a way.
Yeah.
And so people who, you know, don't have a farm in their backyard that they can grow crops, they can actually, so I guess they pay you up front, you said, in the beginning of the season. Yeah. And then for the rest of that season, they can now come once a week and harvest their their food.
Yeah.
And that's really interesting.
And in my part is that I don't harvest for them, but that's more for me because I only have something like 3 days a week left for farming. And I don't have the time to also harvest. I really like to harvest myself because the quality that they can deliver is probably much higher if I harvest, but it will also, if I want to harvest, it will take me something like 2 days.
And what kind of questions do these people ask you? You said they like to ask you questions about the food and the process.
How do I harvest a salad? Or what? I also grow some more special things, and I say, okay, what do I have to do with it? And I think the questions with vegetables are a bit less than with meat. Meat is always interesting. If you're having the topic of meat, there are so much questions.
So they can also get meat from your farm? Or
not for me, but there's I farm at the location of Roe and Femke. It's a boerderij Landlust in Maasland. And they have grass-fed dairy cows, Jersey cows, and they have chickens on pasture with eggs. And I just started with vegetables, and maybe I'm going to expand later as well with some fruits, maybe some chicken, meat chicken. I think I like meat chicken to do, and maybe also some pigs. But we will see.
And where's your farm located?
It's in Maasland. That's Middendelfland. So okay. It's something. Yeah, in Rotterdam, it's something like a 20-25 minute drive. Depends on where you come from. But it's nice. It's near Schipluiden, and Maasland is really beautiful.
And if people want to join the farming like cooperative, they just reach out to you and ask.
Yeah. They go to I have my first website in years because I never have cards and websites. I don't need to. But in this case, it's very really handy. It's called hetmiddenland.nl, and there you can just read how things work and what it will cost. And what I want to achieve.
It's very nice. So I want to basically end with this because we have to get you out of here soon because you have to go teach, right? In the Hague?
Not today. I want to go at home to eat with my wife or my girlfriend because the kids are at school after a few weeks. But I also teach. So I teach at Lentis Melanchthon in Bleiswijk. I teach VMBO kids and MBO kids. On not really farming in the green environment in a way. So I teach butter making and kooi verrijking.
Fascinating.
It is.
No, but so what is that I kind of cut you off from this much earlier when I said we would go back to it, which is so we started with the whole milk thing, right? You're the milk sommelier, disputed by you. So, what is it? Because I think most people, they go to the supermarket, they get the same brand of milk. Maybe they get a different brand if it's in the bonus or something like that. But milk, basically, to most people, I think, tastes the same every single time. And you might have different brands that you prefer. Maybe you prefer half full, 2%, whatever. But
2% is American.
I know. But I have American audience as well, so I have to translate both.
I like 2%.
2% is good, but vitamin D is, I think, a little better. But they're both good.
Don't put vitamin D in it.
Okay. Before we get off into a huge argument, because I'm also passionate about milk. why is it that actually, because you were talking about how one of the things that made you kind of interested in milk in the beginning was that if you're not getting it from a mass-produced source like you would at the supermarket, when you taste real milk before they do all that stuff to it, milk can taste different from every single cow. It can taste different from every single farm. Why is that? What is it about milk that we're not experiencing as normal supermarket, milk consumers?
Because it is the main thing is that milk is just a product to start to do something with it for something else. Eat it with your porridge or in the in the States with your cornflakes.
Oh yeah, man.
I like it as well. So it's just not the yeah. And it's, of course, if you milk cows, you get a lot of milk. It's if you just have a kettle of in the Netherlands, it's something like, in general, it's something like 100 cows a kettle. And if you if they are low producing cows, then it's 15 liters a day, and then it's still a lot. Yeah. So it's in the States, it's something like 600 cows in general. So that's much more.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
but you have more, much more land, so it's sure. It's okay. So it's in that case, it's I understand why it become that way. But it's a pity, because it's okay that the big lake of milk is there, but it's a pity because to only do that with it. So I'm really happy in what's going on here in the Netherlands in the last 5 years. So something like 6-7 years ago, I started as a milk sommelier. And the milk world in the Netherlands looks different nowadays. If you go now to the shop here in the Netherlands, you can choose things. I want to refer especially to two ones. For me, it's a really nice start. If you go to a big supermarket, there are now two new brands. One called Mijn Melk. And Mijn Melk was the first one who did something really interesting. Mijn Melk is a product that was created by a big firm called Lely, and they are into milk robots. And what's really about milk robots is that the cow can decide when she wants to be milked. But what's really interesting about it, that the robot can recognize the cow, so they know that it will be Aaltje 38. And she only...
Or Betsy.
Maybe even Weaver or something.
You know,
Daisy.
So, but the robots recognize the
cow. The cow will recognize the cow and knows, and also testing how much lactose, protein, fat is in the milk.
Wow.
And also if the cow get medicines, or there are some problems some disease, the robots can recognize it, and then you can put your milk out and throw it away.
This is here in the Netherlands. This is
it is international. Wow. Lely is big.
Wow.
But it's nice. It's about robot in general, so we can have other type of robots. You have many type of robots, not only Lely, but Lely is a big one. What you can do with that, if you know, recognize the cow and you can measure the lactose and fat and that sort of thing, then the idea you can also use to use the robot not to throw away the milk when it's bad, but also to put it away when it's good.
Mm.
And that's what they decide to do. So they create a new system around it to just take the milk out and put it in a bottle. And what they did is they have the line of 4 or 5 cows can be milked and put it in a bottle. So that what they create in first Mijn Melk was that they just say, okay, there are family lines in the kettle, the Aagjes and the Antjes and that sort of thing. So they put all the Aagjes just in one bottle and all the Antjes also in one bottle.
What are those? I don't get what you mean with the Aagjes and the Antjes.
Aagjes is the name of the cow. So the weavers okay. and the Betjes and that sort of thing. So they
the
decide.
The here.
We have your Betje 1, Betje 2, Betje 3, Betje 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So they put all the Betjes just in one bottle. And they say, right. Okay, this is the milk from Betje. And for all the Betjes family line, and this is the milk from all the Aagjes family line.
And so you said the thing, and this is another, I guess, key difference between, like, say, milk and wine with the sommelier thing, is you said that milk is rarely ever treated as, like, this is the thing, that the finished thing you're going to drink. Like, yes, of course, people drink it for breakfast and stuff like that, but for the most part, it's going into cereal, it's going into a baking dish, something like that.
There's no attention to it.
Yeah, and wine's not like that. Wine is like, it is the product. Yeah. And so you're saying that's part of the problem, is that people treat it as not the finished product, that it's just going to go into something else. But I mean, personally, milk is actually one of my favorite things to drink. And Dutch people always kind of think that's weird. They say, is it common in the U.S. to drink milk? But it actually is. I mean, we used to drink a glass of milk for breakfast every day. You know, you'd have it just kind of as a snack or something like in the afternoon.
But in the Netherlands, it was also really general. Yeah? It's really nice to know that in the Europe, we are the tallest persons because we drink a lot of milk. So and we have also we have less obesity problems here in the Netherlands because we drink a lot of milk.
But so how would people, I mean, how could a normal person like actually taste some milk that might be where they would be able to appreciate the differences in it like you can with wine? How, you have to just find milk that hasn't gone.
Yeah, but that's, to go back to the Lely story, that's my milk. But then we have Elke milk. Elke milk is really intriguing because they do the same. They use their milk robot, not from Lely, but from another company. And they created a new system behind it. So what they now created is that the milk of the cow from just Aagje 38 is going into the bottle directly. So from milking to bottling is something like 12 minutes. So they're creating a pasteurization process and cooling process in just 12 minutes from milking to... So what the Lely did was just putting the family line in one bottle. But what Elke milk does do is that they put the milk of that cow in one bottle.
So, and okay. So now you can go to the grocery store and you can know which cow you're getting.
Yes. Ah. And what's also interesting, because the robot also measured the lactose and the fat and that sort of thing. So they're creating a system of crosses to say how much lactose, fat, or protein is in the milk.
Right.
So if you go to the shop, it's really nice. If you go to the shop and you buy Elke milk, you never know what you get. So if you want to have Aagje 38, Aagje 38, it will be difficult because it changes all the time. So what you do, you just pack your bottle of milk and you see at the crosses how much lactose, protein and fat content is in there. And if you take another one, this is Aagje 38 and this is batch 15, and you see there it will be different. So it's really nice if you just take three bottles, they will be all different. Mm. So it's a really nice way to just learn as a consumer that milk is not always the same.
Yeah.
And it's 5 years ago or 7 years ago when I started as milk sommelier, that was my dream.
Really?
And it's now in the package. And for me, it's just the first step. So there's much more possible by using that robots, because otherwise it's too cost expensive to create some sort of system if you do it by hand. So it's...
So the technology innovation has kind of allowed it to become more mainstream. That's fascinating that now you can actually go to the grocery store and see, okay, well, this one has this lactose, this one has this fat, and you maybe start to learn, I actually like high lactose milk or I like high fat milk or whatever.
But you can also decide, okay, you know, okay, that the protein and fat is high in a sort of, so it's something like four crosses both, then you know that's also good to foam for your coffee. Mm. And you don't, and if you take... with low of high lactose and low fat and low protein content, it will not foam. So it will also do something else with you, not only drinking, but also using. Or you think, oh, it's nice, there's a nice protein, high protein level. Oh, maybe it's good for pancakes because it's better for a thicker. So it's interesting. Yeah. So it's a good start to experience as a consumer. And and you see other type of milks. You see now milk from the farm. At Albert Heijn, there's a milk from the farm, and it's not homogenized. And in the beginning, in especially if you go to the supermarket, all milk is homogenized.
And homogenized means they just try to make it the same, like all of that milk?
No, that's standardization. But homogenization is real about the fat. So what they do with the fat, they put into some sort of sieve is the correct word, to make all the fat bubbles as small as possible and even. And because it's small, it doesn't float anymore. So you have no texture. But if you're just leaving the fat content intact and also the sizes of the fat, so if you have small fat and bigger fat, and so it will float. And then you have texture. And texture, every chef can tell you that texture is real big part of your flavor and tasting experience.
That's really interesting. I totally agree. And so you said you started your, you know, milk sommelier journey 6-7 years ago, something like that. And so for anybody, basically look up Bas de Groot on YouTube, and you'll see he has this great video where he went to the States. What was the name of that? Clover Farms, right?
Yeah, Sonoma country.
So you go to Sonoma County in California, also big wine country, obviously, but then you go to this guy's dairy farm, you taste his milk, and you guys talk about what all goes into it. And then there's the video from the South Korean commercial, which is super cool. I think for anybody, you can watch that and appreciate it. But
it's difficult to find on YouTube.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's that's a difficult.
I guess I found it from your social media is how I got it. Yeah, but anyway, I'm sure if you do enough advanced Googling, you can find it.
Of course.
But my point is you have this kind of journey. And like you just said, when you started, you wanted people to realize that milk was something that could be appreciated as a beverage that's unique. It has different characteristics, different texture, different flavor. And now over this journey, I mean, going to South Korea, going to the U.S., doing all the workshops and kind of seminar things you used to do here in the Netherlands before COVID and all that stuff kind of killed it all. Now you're here at this point in the journey and you see, like you're just talking about these processes where now you have, what, 3 milk companies that are in supermarkets that are kind of showing those advantages. So how does that feel now to be at this point and see how everything's changed?
I'm really happy with it. And it's also good... I'm a bit fed up with being a milk sommelier. So I think my goal is starting to be reached in a way. So I'm really comfortable with it. And it's, it's really great to see that sort of things that I already told 7 years ago. And and I see also, of course, I'm into milk. So people just sometimes... talk to me and say, "Oh, I just bought that sort of thing," and that's great. And but it's for me, it's just the beginning, or not for me, but it's just the beginning for milk. There we can do much more on differentiation. Well, it's about differentiation, not only about flavor, but in differentiation than we do now. But it's a really good start, and you see that that the company survived, because that was a big concern for me. Was Elke Melk and Mijn Melk that's special enough for people to buy and pay an extra more? But it looks good, so that's great. So there is a market for differentiation. It's not only an idea, but there's also people who demand that sort of ideas as well. So that's good.
For sure. Well, it's been a crazy journey for you, I think.
But yeah, but it's also for me, it's the end. So I just had a small assignment 2 weeks ago for Omroep Friesland. And I have to do a tasting, but also we did a discussion with, or just sitting on a table, to really relaxed one with some other people from Derry. And we did the milk tasting, but we just go really fast with it because I'm not really interested in the tasting anymore.
You've tasted enough milk.
Yeah, but it's also, it's nice to tell people something, but it doesn't bring me anything anymore.
Yeah.
So it's good. We need to have more milk sommelier so I can retire.
Well, no, it's good. Yeah, you want to be passionate about stuff while you're doing it. And I think hopefully there will be more milk sommeliers.
There we are with 3, as far as I know, in the world.
All right, so up to 3.
There's a Scottish guy and there's a Danish guy. And they all do it in a different way.
Nice.
So that's nice.
All right. Well, hey, thanks a lot for doing this, man. I really appreciate it. It was good to get to chat after so long.
It's always nice to chat with you.
Oh, nice to hear what you're doing with the farm. And one more time, what was the website people can go to for that?
Hetmiddenland.nl.
Awesome. Well, best of luck with that. And thanks again for doing this.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it. All right. Bye, guys.